Hello, I'm Councilman Ari Kagan, representing 47th District of Southern Brooklyn, and today I'm going to talk about recent events in New York City. First of all, as council member, I recently participated in a very important meeting hosted by my colleague, Councilwoman Joanna Riola from Queens. It was about prevention of fires. She is a chairwoman of Fire Prevention Committee, and she invited all council members, Republicans and Democrats, to meet representatives of fire department. We talked about fire safety. There is a proposal right now coming from the administration to move some of the functions of New York Fire Department to Department of Buildings, specifically inspections. If it is going to happen, it would be absolute disaster. I understand that city wants to save money on these inspections. I understand that fire department inspections are usually much more expensive than Department of Building inspections. But you know what? We will save money here, but then we will lose lives because it will be much more fires. Why? During this meeting, it became absolutely clear, obvious to everyone that moving inspections from fire department to Department of Buildings will lead to very lax enforcement. Very often, Department of Buildings inspectors are not they're not trained the way fire department inspectors. They're not looking at things that fire department inspectors are looking for. Also, there is a term self-certification, meaning management can say, listen, this is okay, this is fine, we are confident everything is fine, this is the picture, this is the video, this is the documentation, and then they're sending this to Department of Buildings. It's a self-certification. We watched it horrifying video of one manager who basically put a fake door inside his apartment, inside his building, made a video and did self-certification, and then inspector from the fire department came and noticed that this is all fake. It's just like fraud. So if it would not be this good inspectors, can you imagine what's going to happen later on? We already have too many fires, tragic fires in our city, and our city is growing. We have almost 9 million people, a lot of old buildings, a lot of tall buildings. If this important issue, fire inspections, would be moved from fire department, it will be many more tragedies. We cannot afford this, and the meeting I was talking about, hosted by Councilwoman Joanna Riola from Queens, was extremely important. It will be public hearing about this topic, and I already realize I would be strongly against changing the current procedure. It should be done only by inspectors of the fire department to make sure that we are safe. We cannot afford, it's not a joke, it's a very serious stuff. Again, we have so many buildings, and fire safety and public safety are very, very important. Also important to note that in this meeting, there were Republicans and Democrats, council members from both parties, because when it is a fire, nobody asking what is your party affiliation. Either you safe or you're not safe. And we cannot afford to have so many tragedies all over the places in New York City. That's one important topic to talk about. Second, also related to buildings. I already mentioned previously about upcoming problem with Local Law 97 that was approved in 2019 by previous City Council. I was not in City Council in 2019. I did not vote for this legislation. If I would be at that time, I would definitely vote against it because it's so-called unfunded mandate, meaning when government imposes something on businesses, on building owners, on property owners, on residents without giving any kind of tax credits, any kind of tax incentives, any kind of financial abilities to pay for it. So just this week we voted in New York City Council for another proposal, and originally the goal of this legislation is very, very good that we voted this week. The goal was to get rid of very old fuel. So a lot of buildings in New York City are using very old fuel when it comes to electricity, when it comes to hot water, when it comes to heat. And of course, many buildings are very, very old. and they use very unhealthy, toxic fuel. Of course, it should be replaced. And the previous legislation was talking about 2000 Tory. But now we had the vote to accelerate this process, to make it sure everything is replaced by 2027. But if you do not implement it, then it's a penalty. Same story like the law I mentioned before, LL97. Meaning, if buildings do not comply, if they do not do it by 2027, if they do not replace old fuel, if they do not have money to replace everything, they will have to pay penalties. Moreover, even if they replaced everything according to the new law, then they need to comply with LL97 and to pay millions and millions more. They will still face penalties. And in case of local law 97, we're talking about tens of millions of dollars. I recently participated in a meeting with management and board of directors of Vorbas houses in my own district, and they told me that just to comply with all requirements of local law 97, they have to spend ready more than $100 million. And where did they get this money from? Do you think state government will give them some kind of tax credits? Do you think city government is giving them some? No. Oh, you are rich people. It's the rich people who live in Vorbas houses. Are you kidding me? We're talking about middle class people. We're talking about retirees. We're talking about police officers, nurses, firefighters, teachers, people who are municipal retirees. They cannot afford to pay double or triple maintenance every month because government told them you have to do it, and preferably as soon as possible. Accelerated schedule. Again, the idea is correct idea in terms of to be environmentally friendly. And I support this. What I don't support is unfunded mandate when government says you have to do it by certain time, otherwise millions of dollars penalty. And where you're going to get money for it? We don't know. We just don't know. Like just double the maintenance fee, for example. Take a loan, high interest loan from some kind of bank. And again, in case of Vorbas houses, we're talking about $100 million. In case of some other co-ops in Queens, I was at press conference, and the president of co-op said it will cost them $65 million. So again, it should be just stage by stage, it should be long term, and it should be tax credits. It should be some financial assistance from city, state, and federal government to all of these co-ops, to all of these buildings, old and new ones. It cannot be like, just do it, that's all. And who is going to pay for it? New Yorkers. It's squeezing New Yorkers. And when we are squeezing New Yorkers? During the time of the high inflation, where dozen of X is $8, so at this time we have to help people instead of saying, no, let's double their maintenance fee, let's increase their rent. Because if management cannot pay itself for all of these renovations and cannot replace fuel by themselves, they will increase rent, they will increase maintenance fee. So it will come down back to all of us. It will affect not just rich people, but also to everybody, middle class and low income New Yorkers. That's why I voted against it. And I said it's another unfunded mandate, and that's why I was totally against it. So that's news from City Hall. Also, as council member, I'm proud to visit all of the good, great organizations in my district, visit police stations, visit firefighters. So it was, St. Valentine's Day, the day of love. Yeah. Besides giving flowers to my wife, of course, I had to visit also firefighters, police officers, EMS workers, to say them thank you and to show love and respect. I bought cookies in local bakeries, like New York Bread on Neptune Avenue or Bread Plus on Harvey Avenue. And I delivered these cookies and these sweets to police precincts all over southern Brooklyn, again, to show my respect, appreciation, and love to our first responders. And I know that some other of my colleagues also do the same, though some of my colleagues constantly talking, we need less police. We need as less police as possible. In fact, now we have a progressive caucus in New York City Council that wants everyone who is a member of that caucus to sign a pledge to reduce the scope and funding for NYPD. Why? Because we have a gun violence. Because we have a high crime in New York City. Oh, a lot of crimes. Gun violence, let's reduce number of police officers. Absurd, completely opposite. We need to increase number of police officers. And do you know what is the starting salary of police officer? Starting salary is $42,500 a year. I'm preparing a legislation to increase this starting salary of police officers. Talking about school safety, do you know that today usually one school safety officer for every school? One for one school. Imagine, I recently talked to principal and he told me 1,200 students in his school, one school safety officer. If this usually it's a women of color, by the way. So she wanted to go to the bathroom. She cannot leave like unattended. So she called principal, she called the office, and they sent school aide. While school safety officer was in the bathroom and school aide replaced her while she was in the bathroom. It was a some disturbance in the school. It was some fight between two groups of students. So how school aide could like could do anything? She is not trained to do so. So that would be my next legislation, to make sure that every school has at least two school safety officers, not one. And do you know why we have issue with school safety officers? Because the starting salary of school safety officer is $35,000 a year. Who wants to work as a school safety officer if it's a very responsible, important, and sometimes dangerous job? With, by the way, they are unarmed, as you know. They don't have gun or anything like this. And $35,000 a year, one school safety officer for 1,000 students, give me a break. That's why we have problem recruiting the school safety officer. So I would like to change it as a council member. And finally, I always say you cannot just do law enforcement and to prevent crime. No. To prevent crime, you need to do it twofold: to support law enforcement and also to support our youth programs, after school programs, any programs that make sure that our youth are doing the productive things like sports, computers, arts, music, dances. So as council member, I give funding from New York City Council, from taxpayers, from city budget, to help all of these youth programs. And in particular, one of the programs, I just visited them this week, very effective program. It's called Center for Employment Opportunities. I like even the name, Center for Employment Opportunities. They're targeting young folks, primarily from minority communities, age 18 to 25, who are on parole, at-risk youth, and also on probation. So most of these folks already had some problem with the law. Already, whether they were arrested sometimes for maybe for minor violations, for misdemeanors, and so on. Or like they're at risk of getting into trouble, getting breaking the law. So again, the Center for Employment Opportunities, working with them, training them, giving them jobs. Usually it's manual jobs, $15 per hour minimum wage, but it's still very good in my opinion. What I saw, I like it. It was at Marlboro Houses, and they did basically, they helped NYCHA workers to clean up maintenance work over there in Marlboro Houses. Yes, it's a low level job. Yes, it's just $15 per hour, but when I talked to them, they were very, very happy. First of all, it's money. Money is money, even $15 per hour. Second of all, they're coming on time, they're signing timesheets, they're learning work discipline. They are under supervision. And if they're working like this for 3 months, no violations, no skipping, no cutting corners, and doing everything right, they can get full-time job at NYCHA, at Parks Department, and some other places. So it's opening some doors. It's a way out of troubles. So I believe it's a good organization. So I gave them funding from my discretionary funding, allocated, secured funding from New York City Council. Again, it's taxpayers' money, but in this case, in my opinion, I am spending this money wisely, helping these young people to be productive members of American society. I believe that's the right approach. And of course, I'm a big supporter. I'm going today to celebrate Black History Month with Coney Island Sharks, another amazing organization in Coney Island that I strongly support. 150 kids of all ages, American football, also volunteering for the community. Also, they have girls over there, Sharkettes, Coney Island Sharkettes. It's basically dancing, cheerleaders. But even more important, these boys and girls in this program, Coney Island Sharks, they're doing community service. They're volunteering at various events in the community. So I'm very proud to be their supporter. quarter and to give them funding again from New York City Council. So thank you so much for your attention. Wish you only good luck, good health. Councilman Ari Kagan.